Verse 7. Just one verse that I'm actually preaching from this evening. It's 20 verse 7. In fact, I'm really only preaching from the first half of this verse. Something 1:7-8 in the church Bibles. On the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. Paul spoke to the people, and because he intended to leave the next day, he kept on talking until midnight. So I'm basically looking at the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. Let's now ask the Lord to help us to look into the Word. Father, we thank you that your Word has been inspired as a whole. Whole of the Bible, it's also been, Lord, inspired by you, expired, breathed out by you, and infallible and inerrant in its parts, right down, Lord, to even individual verses and half of verses. Thank you, Lord, that your word is the truth, and we pray, Lord, tonight that you will instruct our minds, but also we pray that you would inflame our hearts with truths in these verses we're looking at now. In Jesus' name, amen. So on the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. Paul is here being referred to. The we is Luke, who wrote Luke's Gospel. Commentators down the ages have deduced that Luke had a travel diary, which comprises a small part of the Acts of the Apostles. And this part comes from these we sections, this travel diary, that Luke used to compile his history of the spread of the gospel in the early church. And so he says on the first day that we came together to break bread, a very simple expression, and yet this contains two explosive controversial topics in the history of the church. The first is the first day of the week, the Lord's Day, which I've looked at obliquely and sometimes directly in the last few weeks as I've been preaching. Secondly, breaking bread, the Lord's Supper, Holy Communion, the Eucharist, different words used to refer to the same thing. And I want you to notice straight away that these two ideas share a similar feature. There aren't that many references to them in the New Testament. What I mean is that if you look at the breaking of bread, the communion, outside of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and 1 Corinthians chapters 10 and 11, there are no references to the Lord's Supper in the whole of the New Testament. That's quite amazing. There probably are more references to the idea of the Lord's Day, the first day of the week, the gathering together of people in the presence of the risen Jesus, the day of Pentecost, which of course was on the first day of the week, probably more references to the Lord's Day in that sense in the New Testament than even to be than actually the breaking of bread. Now, and then this, of course, is really interesting because you won't find any skeptic, any Seventh-day Adventist, or anybody who denies the Lord's Day ever say, because there are only a few references to communion or the Lord's Supper in the New Testament, that it was an invention of the early church. You just don't find it. People don't say that. People don't say, oh, there's very few references in the New Testament to the Last Supper, to communion. Therefore, it was invented by the early church. You do find many people who oppose the idea of the Lord's Day who say just that about the Lord's Day, because there are few references. Now, the reason why there are relatively few references to the Lord's Supper in the rest of the New Testament is because the Lord's Supper, like the Lord's Day, was something of so widespread acceptance by Christians, so unquestioned by Christians, that it was never thought that important to mention it. It was taken for granted that the churches in Thessalonica, the churches in Philippi, the churches all over Greece and Asia were having the Lord's Supper. Mentioned in the letters, and indeed meeting together on the first day of the week, on the Lord's Day. Things that are mentioned in passing are often things that are taken for granted that are always happening. I say that to begin with because in the last few weeks I've been reading quite a lot of books about
Laws Day and the Sabbath.
So in my digital library, I have, in other words, a computerized library full of PDFs of old books and a few newer ones. I have a book by a guy called Andrews, which was called The History of the Sabbath. I had no idea who this chap was. Plowed through the book, I could tell it was a 19th century book, and he laid a concerted attack upon the idea that the Lord's Day, Sunday, was, and the first day of the week, in other words, was the day when we should be worshipping, and attacked the whole idea, saying that, you know, we should be worshipping God on the Saturday, on the Sabbath day. Only when I did a bit of research, in other words, I looked up Wikipedia, did I discover that he was one of the leaders of the movement of the Seventh-day Adventists in the 19th century. I didn't know anything about Seventh-day Adventists, apart from, I remember Kellogg, who invented Kellogg's Corn Flakes, was a Seventh-day Adventist, a rather eccentric chap. And also I remember reading vaguely that they were vaguely legalistic. But of course, what we do know is about Seventh-day Adventists is they say those people who worship God on a Sunday, worship Christ on a Sunday, are disobeying Scripture. In fact, in their early writings, they claim that we who keep Sundays will one day have a mark of the beast on us. Of course, modern Seventh-day Adventists don't tell us anything about their original views. In fact, with Seventh-day Adventism, you look online at their websites and you find it hard at first to discover any difference between Orthodox Evangelical Christianity and their views. But actually, Seventh-day Adventism started with a prophetess who claimed to have visions of God. During a prayer meeting, shortly after disappointment, as it's called, great disappointment to the sect she belonged to, because they were expecting Christ to come again, just like this e-Bible church was predicting that Christ would come last week or something. Well, he didn't come. And after this, she got these compensating prophecies, which became the foundation for Seventh-day Adventism. And Seventh-day Adventism has as their belief that you've got the Bible, and yet then you have to have these woman's prophecies as well, as authoritative for the church. They keep quiet about that generally. That is still the teaching. And then one of the visions was, she had a vision of the Ten Commandments. In it, each of the Ten Commandments was written out on kind of stones or monuments. But right at the center of all these Ten Commandments was a light shone on one big monument that said, you know, that you should keep the Sabbath and maintain the Sabbath as a holy day. Now, Seventh-day Adventism, contains within its doctrines, its original doctrines, a denial of just beginning with faith. They claim that Jesus is carefully accounting, investigating the sins of Christians. It's one of Jesus' major occupations in heaven. That's one of the foundational teachings. And he's carefully looking at the sins of Christians to get ready to rubbish the Christians who have continued in sin in their life, have sins in their life, and aren't right with God. They deny a belief in eternal punishment. They claim that unless you are baptized in water, you can't be saved. And so, of course, they find it difficult to deal with the thief on the cross, and of course was saved just by believing in Jesus. And they claim that Christians who worship on a Sunday are basically doing the devil's work. That's the original views of the Seventh-day Adventists. Now, you may say, well, that's the original views, so why would I dare to kind of criticize contemporary Seventh-day Adventists who don't have such narrow, restrictive, and heretical views? The answer, of course, is that there's something wrong with it as a movement. As a Reformed Baptist, frankly, if I found out 150 years ago that the Reformed Baptists were kind of kind of like constituted 350
years ago.
But if I found out 150 years ago, the foundation of Reformed Baptist belief was diametrically opposite to evangelical Christianity, to Bible Christianity, I would want to know. I want to be involved with it. And that, there may be Seventh-day Adventists today who are Christians, I believe there are, I believe I fellowship with one or two in my time, doesn't affect the fact that the teaching itself is fundamentally wrong. And without, you know, spending any more time on the other issues, let's look at this question of what happened on the first day of the week. And that's why we're going to get back to Acts chapter 20 and verse 7, which says, on the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. Now, first thing to understand is that this day was a day when Paul could have been somewhere else. We know he was hurrying, trying to get to Jerusalem before Pentecost. And it says in verse 6, we sailed from Philippi after the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and 5 days later joined the others at Troas, where we stayed 7 days. Now, from looking at these travel journeys, Paul was in a rush and a hurry to get there, but he delayed 7 days to stay in this small place, small church, to spend Sunday with them. That tells us something. His very behaviour shows that he thought that it was important. On the first day of the week, he actually broke bread with those believers. The second thing is, of course, it doesn't say, oh, well, he broke bread with him on the third day he got there, and then he buzzed off further on his journey. It's not at all. He waited until the first day of the week, Sunday, later to call the Lord's Day, until he broke bread. Now, here's another interesting fact. Nowhere in the whole of the New Testament does it ever say he broke bread on a Sabbath day. Here again is the strange beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventists, because they, of course, only celebrate the Lord's Supper 4 times a year, by the constitution of their beliefs. But when they, you know, celebrate the Lord's Day, it's on a Sabbath day, it's on Sunday, not on the first day of the week. And so they actually are completely going against what Scripture is telling us. The first day of the week was when people came together to break bread. We see that this first day of the week was a day of phenomenal divine activity. We know this from the rest of the New Testament, in the early church. The Lord's Day was a time when God exploded into history by raising his son from the dead. And then, of the appearances of Jesus over the next 7 weeks, the only day, specific day that is mentioned that Jesus appeared was the first day of the week. There aren't that many appearances that are actually described in the Acts of the Apostles or the other Gospels, John's Gospel, after the day of resurrection. But when there's actually a specific day that is mentioned, it is only on Sunday that it is mentioned. Not many references to that. But after 7 weeks, the birthday of the church is on the first day of the week. Pentecost was on a Sunday. And after 7 weeks, the 50 days after that Sabbath day at Passover, the Holy Spirit is poured out upon the church. Phenomenal activity of God. And these landmarks in those early Christians' lives surely was one of the reasons why, from a very early stage, the first day of the week became the day of Jesus, became the Lord's Day, the day belonging to the Lord. I mean, we find on that very first Sunday, that very first Lord's Day, after the Holy Spirit was given, we have 3,000 people baptized on that very first Sunday. Those who accepted his message, Peter's message, were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day, that first Sunday of Pentecost. Now, likewise, we have on a much smaller level in Paul's journeys, we have in Acts chapter 16 a reference to a Sunday. You may not have ever seen this reference from the time, I never noticed it, so I looked at it a bit more closely. But we know that Paul was arrested in Philippi as he was on his way on a Sabbath day to the lakeside. Now we know that Paul's evangelistic method was to start with the Jewish people. On the Sabbath day he would find a synagogue, or in this case in Philippi there was what was called a place of prayer. If you couldn't find 10 adult males, you couldn't set up a synagogue. And there wasn't in Philippi 10 adult males, but women in particular are mentioned who gathered together by the riverside to pray in a prosuke, a place of prayer. And riversides were particular places where Jewish people often used to gather. So if they went to a town, they would go to the nearby river and they would hope to see if there were some fellow Jews where they could pray. And of course what happened was, on their way to the place of prayer, we're seeing on verse 16 of Acts 16, once when we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit by which she predicted the future. What happens? Paul throws out the evil spirit that's giving her this fortune-telling ability. The owners of the slave girl realize their hope of making money was gone. They seize Paul and Silas, bring him before the magistrates. And the magistrates, without giving him due process or a fair trial, have them severely flogged. They're thrown into prison. And there they are on that Sabbath afternoon, thrown into prison. And on the evening, and that's as the Jews would have seen it, the evening of the first day of the week. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Now, what is interesting is, the next morning, after the miracle of the earthquake and of the jailer becoming a Christian, what happens on that first Sunday morning is that Paul makes a complaint. The jailer, of course, is down on his side. And the magistrates realize they've done something wrong because Paul was a Roman citizen and they shouldn't have dealt with him without trial. And they then released them. So it says, verse 39, they came to appease them and escorted them from the prison, requesting them to leave the city. But they didn't go out of the city. Why not? Because they would go to Lydia's house. What to do? Because they knew that there'd be a meeting there. It was the Lord's day. Doesn't say that in the text, but I think it's a reasonable assumption. After Paul and Silas came out of the prison, they went to Lydia's house, where they met with the brothers. Well, how did they know the brothers were there? How did the brothers know that Paul was going to be released on that morning? Why did they gather at Lydia's house? Maybe you could say they gathered that in that morning to pray. Perhaps that's so, but it actually gives the impression to me that actually they were going there to meet with the other brothers, the other converts, precisely because on the Lord's day, it was usual to meet together and to break bread. We're told also in 1 Corinthians 16 and verse 2, Paul actually mentions the first day of the week, specifically when it's talking about collections. 1 Corinthians 16:2 says, well, starting in verse 1, now about the collection for God's people. Do what I told the Galatian churches to do. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money, keeping within income, saving it up so that when I come, no collections will have to be made. Now, it is possible that this could be interpreted as a private collection at home, although it seems more likely in most commentators of all kinds of hues of view, tend to think this is a reference to a meeting in which money is set aside, that week by week is collected, so that eventually there's going to be a big collection for the poor in Jerusalem. But even if it was actually a private thing, again, it implies the first day of the week was a week in which, before the Lord, you did a holy act of Christian discipleship, giving, before the Lord, on the Lord's day. Now, look, some of what I've been trying to say is this, that there is no basis at all for believing that the Christians carried on worship, having Saturday as the day of worship. There's no basis at all, despite what Seventh-day Adventists try to paint the picture as. There's no basis for saying that the transition from Saturday to Sunday came from the Catholic Church. In other words, it was the Catholic Church's authority of a later time after the Apostles that made Sunday that special day of worship. There's no basis at all for that, because we see it happening in the New Testament, and we see in the 30 or 40 years after the Apostles had died, we have evidence both from non-Christian documents and Christian documents that the first day of the week was the special day for the worship of the Lord. And so we see that we have an unbroken line going back to the time of the Apostles, of Christians gathering together to meet with the Lord on this day, the Lord's Day. Now, the second thing I want to notice from Acts 20 and verse 7 is this, that the specific thing which is at the centre to their Sunday worship was the breaking of bread. Let's think a bit about this, the breaking of bread. First thing to notice this is that the breaking of bread is a really significant expression. Amongst the Jews, and for the Romans of course, sharing a meal was to do with fellowship, it was to do with friendship, generosity, hospitality. But when Jesus broke bread in the Gospels, he was indicating that his body was going to be broken for the disciples. Now, I want us to think about our taking of the bread, taking of the wine. When we have our communion, or Eucharist, or whatever word we want to use to express the Lord's Supper, Calvin in the Institute spends 60-70 pages talking about Holy Communion, talking about the breaking of bread. And of course, a lot of that time is spent with controversies, dealing with problems of interpretation between the Roman Catholics, Lutherans, Zwingli, and so on and so forth. But a lot of it is dealing with what he calls this marvellous truth about our relationship with Christ in heaven. And she starts off by saying that these things are so important, so marvellously, wonderfully important, that we can hardly put it into words how wonderful it is that we on earth, somehow, during the breaking of bread on a Sunday, are sharing the life in heaven of Jesus Christ. Of course, there's all kinds of complexities, which we just don't have time to think about tonight, about how indeed the bread and the wine are linked to the person of Jesus Christ in heaven. We wouldn't really have time to go into those things, maybe another point. But what is absolutely important is to understand that the taking of the bread and wine is central to a Christian's life. It's not an add-on option. It's not something that's, oh yeah, we break bread every month, or every 2 weeks, or every week, or even every day for that matter. It's not a question of, oh, it's something that happens. It is central. Now, we only have to look at Acts 2:42 to see that this is so. Those 5,000 converts who were converted on the Lord's Day, on that first day of the week, on the day of Pentecost, it tells us about them in Acts 2:42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. To the fellowship and breaking of bread. In fact, those two ideas are joined in the original language, the Greek language. Fellowship and breaking of bread. And so it's important, just in the few minutes we have tonight, for us to think about this. We're hoping to have evening breakings of bread, evening or afternoon celebration of the Lord's Supper, and I hope that many people will be devoting themselves to the breaking of bread, to thinking about it, to be involved in it, and to gain from its riches. I include myself in this. The first thing to note is that the breaking of bread is very closely linked to the idea of the body and blood of Christ. And we looked in John and earlier and saw Jesus' teaching about this. But let's actually now look at what Paul says in the institution of the Lord's Supper that he passes on in 1 Corinthians, page 1784 in the Church Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Paul says, "I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he gave thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Now we'll see that this action of taking bread, taking wine, and giving it to people by Jesus is meant to be an acted sermon. Jesus was giving to his disciples. And when we take bread and wine, we are taking from Jesus. We must understand that the Lord is in heaven, but by his Holy Spirit, he mediates his presence to us now when we're taking the bread and the wine. And indeed, although there's, someone giving out bread and wine, and I don't think it matters who gives out the bread and the wine. Calvin appears to think this too, and he talks about matters of indifference to do with the actual giving of the bread and the wine. It doesn't really matter whether, it's passed round with no one giving it out, or whether, what person presiding gives out. That's irrelevant. The point is this: when we receive the bread and the wine, we are receiving it directly from Jesus Christ. Now that's a hard thing to do. If you're not a Christian, you don't get that at all. But even for a Christian, it's hard to get that. That when we're sitting here and someone is handing you a bit of bread and giving you a little cup of grape juice, that Jesus himself is giving you this directly. He knows that you are you. He knows that you are receiving this piece of bread and a piece of wine. But he is. That's the first thing. And more importantly, he's giving you that which those things signify. Bread and wine are just a symbol. They're not in themselves actually Jesus' body. Well, of course, this is the mistake of the Catholic Church. And not only a mistake, a terrible, terrible, wicked lie of the Catholic Church. But the bread is actually the actual body of Jesus. There are Catholic writers that talk about the priest being, and only the priest, not ordinary people of course, just the elite priests, being holding God, controlling God. As though the priest was actually, able to control God. Talking these terms. No, Jesus is talking about spiritual significance. It's being given to you when we take bread and wine. And this link of Christ with the believers is very important. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 11 that it's a remembrance meal. 11:25, he received from the Lord in the same way after the supper. He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." And it is very important that our minds are involved in remembering Jesus. He goes on to say also that in verse 26, "Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." It's a proclamation of Jesus' death until he comes. Now, this remembrance of Jesus is not just an intellectual remembrance. We can remember the story of Jesus in Matthew and Mark, Luke and John. As important as that is, but it's not just that. In just the same way as when someone tells the story of Jesus from the gospel, that is proclaiming the good news. So taking bread and wine and receiving it is actually a proclamation, a preaching. a living sermon of the nature of the gospel. I'm starving, I'm hungry, I need something to eat. Oh, I'll eat a biscuit or I'll eat something. I am a sinner. I'm a wretched, ruined, rubbish person, and I'm starving to death. And Jesus gives us food. And it's acted out. You know, we're here and someone is giving us a piece of bread to eat, which signifies the assuaging of our hunger physically. Our hunger is being slightly assuaged by a little morsel of bread, but it's actually talking about this wonderful nourishment coming from Christ to us. So it's a remembrance, but it's more than a remembrance. And of course, that's why the Word of God is so important. Says in the Institute, you can't separate the Word of God from the communion meal. There needs to be the preaching of the significance of this constantly in our lives. Constant preaching of the gospel in the church. And of course, the use of scriptures when we're thinking about that and meditating about communion. But again, it's more than just a remembrance. Now, one of the major areas of controversy amongst the reformers was about communion. The guy who kicked off the Reformation, Luther, had a major colloquy, a major meeting, conversation, debate, discussion with another reformer from Switzerland called of England, a few years before Calvin, but in which they came to blows, not literally, but certainly in a theological sense. And the colloquy broke up in complete non-agreement and to a certain extent a bit of animosity between the two of them. Because Zwingli was saying strongly, look, this is a remembrance meal. It's not got anything to do with the Catholic idea of actually that the bread actually becomes the body of Jesus and the wine actually becomes the blood of Jesus. It's just to remember these things. Whereas Luther was taking a much more strong view about the nature of the presence of Christ in the bread and the wine. How can we go into this? But I do want us to notice that Zwingli was right, but he was wrong. He was right in the sense that yes, it's a remembrance meal, but it's more than just a remembrance meal. Now, for instance, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul is talking about the relationship with pagan temples, and he gives an example using the Lord's Supper. And he says in 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 16, is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? Is not the cup of thanksgiving? Of course, that's from the word thanksgiving there, it's from where people get the idea of the Eucharist, which is a perfectly valid name for the Lord's Supper. It is a thanksgiving meal. Cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks, a participation in the blood of Christ. Now, if you go back to the Old Geneva Bible, which was the English translation of Calvin's translation, we find, is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks, a communion in the blood of Christ? And here's where the word communion comes from. King James Version uses the same word. A communion in the blood of Christ. What's a communion? Communion is a word to do with a kind of, you might say, an interaction, a participation, a holy participation together. Koinonia is often used for fellowship. Here, Paul isn't, though, talking about fellowship, participation with other believers primarily, though of course the Last Supper is participating in fellowship with other believers, but this isn't what he's directly referring to in this verse. He's talking here about our fellowship, our union, our participation in Jesus himself. And he compares it with the unholy communion of the pagans, who he talked about the fact in verse 18, he says, consider the people of Israel, let those who eat the sacrifices participate in the altar. Do I mean that a sacrifice offered to an idol is anything? Or that an idol is anything? No, but the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God. And I don't want you to be participants with demons. And so Paul is telling us that when we are taking the bread and the wine, we are sharing in the life of Jesus Christ, as distinct from the pagans, who share in the life of demons. So communion is more than just remembering something. It is actually enjoying in the present our union with Christ. It is actually the moment that we're going through and we're praying, we're praising the Lord for his death on the cross and his love for us. We are actually causing our spiritual life to be more and more melded into and united with and flowing with the life of Christ himself. And this is a great and marvelous ideal. But I said I thought Zwingli was right as well as being wrong. There is a way, of course, of combining the idea of this wonderful fellowship with Jesus Christ in the taking of the bread and the wine with our day-to-day Christian life, which I think perhaps Zwingli was trying to get at. In other words, we're told in John's Gospel, we're told by Jesus that all of the time in our Christian lives, as we are believing in Jesus Christ, as we are having faith in him, we are united with him, it's all throughout John's Gospel, and that we are enjoying the life from heaven, the bread from heaven that's coming down from the world. But Jesus says that. You know, that in John's Gospel, that these are enjoyed by the believing disciple. And so it is quite possible that we can have all of the benefits of the death of Christ in our day-to-day Christian living, even though we are not actually taking the bread and the wine at that time. We are participating in Christ, we're in union with him, we are bearing fruit for him. But what the New Testament appears to be making clear is that it's particularly when we take the bread and the wine that the special significance of our union with Jesus is preached to our soul with power. God has constructed a sermon, not just in words, but also in symbols, that is particularly effective in awakening our faith, increasing our faith, and helping us to meditate and grow in our knowledge of Jesus Christ. It's not unique. We can have exactly that same kind of fellowship outside of the communion meal. But the communion meal, Lord's Supper, Eucharist, is particularly designed for us to actually grow in our union with the Lord Jesus. And that's why the early Christians were devoted to the breaking of bread, because it increased their faith, increased their love for the Lord. Let me finally finish, because time has gone, is to know also that in these passages we're told that communion also has other important things associated with it. For instance, an important thing is unity and love. Paul says that in verse 16, it's not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks, a participation in the blood of Christ. And it's not the bread that we break, a participation in the body of Christ. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. Can't say too much about that verse, there's complications involved in it, but what Paul is definitely telling us is that during communion, our unity for one another grows. The reason why in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 he is very, very critical of the Corinthians was because that they showed an unloving attitude to fellowship. They showed a disunity. They were in a situation where they had a meal and showed selfishness and disunity in relationship with one another. Because communion is meant to express and is meant to increase our actual love for one another. Now, I'm just going to finish by these words from Calvin. How do we take this communion worthily? Because, of course, in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul actually says if someone takes the bread and the wine unworthily, they're guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Calvin's got some absolutely wonderful words. He says this: let's remember this sacred feast is a medicine for the sick, solace for sinners, charity for the poor, but would bring no benefit for the healthy, righteous, and rich, if any could be found. For since it is in Christ is given to us as food, we understand that without Jesus, we would pine away, starve and faint, as famine destroys the vigor of the body. Therefore, this is the worthiness that we need, the best and only kind we can bring to God, to offer our vileness, and so to speak, our unworthiness to Him, so that His mercy may make us worthy. To despair in ourselves, so that we may be comforted in Him. To abase ourselves, so that we may be lifted up by Him. To accuse ourselves, so that we may be justified by Him. To aspire to that unity which He commends to us in His Son, so that He makes all of us one in Himself, to desire one soul, one heart, one tongue for us all. If we wait and consider these things, well, these thoughts, though they may stagger us, will never lay us low. How could we, needy, bear all good, foul with sins, half dead, eat the Lord's body worthily? Rather, we shall think that we, as being poor, come to a kindly giver, as sick to a physician, as sinners to a saviour. And Lord, help us as we think about communion, taking the bread and the wine more often in the future. And Lord, help us to come to Him in this worthy manner. Let's just finish with a word of prayer. Oh, we ask You to help us in our own meditation to think about what it means to be united with Christ, to participate in Him, to share His life. And though, Lord, there are many things we have not yet fully understood or explained about the taking of the bread and the wine, we pray, Lord, that You may give to each of us that simple understanding from Your word, that we may actually glorify You, give thanks to You, be united to You, be loving one another, be united with the fellowship of believers as we take bread and wine. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.